It's nice in the scriptures when you actually get a picture of what they're seeing and looking at. Themes in this message is that God doesn't always fit our pattern. When the church got started, it was just Jewish people who were part of the church. That seemed to make sense. That's where the church got started, and that's who lived there. And so that's they were part of the church. And everybody knew Jesus was the Jewish Messiah. They knew back. They didn't know when. Some of them thought it might be right away. And so they were kind of waiting in Jerusalem for him to come back. God broke open their pattern. He made them think differently. He made them realize, okay, it's not just for the Israelites. It's for everybody. And so everyone was then welcomed into the church of God, and God used Cornelius' person in. But there's another way that Cornelius is a bit different as well. And he doesn't follow the typical conversion story that many people have. There was a Lutheran theologian who lived shortly after Luther. He was one of the first early theologians after the Reformation. His name was Nicholas Hunius, and we've talked a bit about him in the Pilgrim's Progress Bible studies that some of you have done. And he said that there's a typical way adults grow in their faith, and he kind of laid it out in five steps. He said, first you get a call from God, you sense God kind of nudging you, and then you learn a little bit about who this God is, and learn enough to understand a few basics and to be intrigued. Then you get saved. You realize, okay, you're not perfect, you need God's help, and you ask for that help and that forgiveness, and you're saved. Then you grow spiritually. You have, maybe some people have spiritual encounters even. And then you grow in terms of who you are as a person. You become a better person, you do good things, some of your bad habits you're able to kind of deal with and get rid of. And that last step is called sanctification, by the way. So those are the five steps that people go through. And when this Lutheran theologian proposed this, it really caught on with all the Protestants in Europe, not just the Lutherans, but everybody. And they really liked this idea. And the book Pilgrim's Progress is written about a guy who goes through those five steps. He gets called first, he learns a little bit, then he gets saved. He has a spiritual connection. And then the rest of the book is about how he kind of improves and matures as a person. But notice with Cornelius, does he go through those five steps? He does. But he goes through them backwards, right? Which is interesting. First, he's a good guy. He does all these good things for people. And so this angel then shows up and says, God recognizes the good things you've done. So doing all the good stuff, that's step five. But then he has this spiritual encounter. The angel and the Holy Spirit comes. That's step four. Then he says, what just happened? Him and his family. So they get saved. That's step three. Then they learn a little bit about what they got saved into, that's step two. And finally, both they and the whole Christian church has to wrestle with what does this mean for our direction, our calling, not just for Cornelius, but the whole church. So they recognize, they wrestle with God's call. So they go through the steps, but they go through them backwards, right? And that's really interesting. So what do we learn from that? Well, we learn that as long as God gets people to the same place, roughly, he can take different means and different ways of approaching people depending on who they are, right? Some people, when they're learning about the church and Christianity, they get really emotional, they get really passionate, they get really into it. Others don't, at least not on the outside. They're a little more quiet and they're more methodical. They just kind of think things through, say, oh, you know, they're very rational about it. Some people have conversion experiences, others don't. There's this one Lutheran theologian says everybody has to have two conversion experiences. You got to first try to follow God, and then when you come to the end of you realize you can't do it all on your own, you have to discover God's grace. But even that, I think, probably doesn't apply to everybody. So God is able to work with different people depending on who they are, as long as he gets them where they need to go. And he knows, he created us differently, so he knows how best to connect with each of us. But there's something else that's interesting about Cornelius. One of the curious things about this story, Cornelius sees this angel. You know, I don't know about you, but I've never seen an angel. He'll speak to me, but so this is pretty significant. Cornelius gets this angel talking to him, and the angel says, go talk to Peter. Why couldn't the angel have just saved Cornelius and Peter the time and told Cornelius the whole gospel right then and there? I think there's three reasons, and that we can learn something from this too. First, God is encouraging us, whenever we're trying to follow his leading and learn about who he is, to check things out, right? To verify things, to confirm things. There's been stories of people who they think they have a leading from God and they act almost on impulse and maybe they get it wrong, right? And sometimes they get it wrong and they embarrass themselves a bit. Sometimes even worse things happen. People have started cults and that kind of thing on they get a certain nudge in a certain direction. Now, I do believe God can lead people and direct people. That's true. But when he does that, he encourages us to check it out, to talk to some other Christians and say, do you think I'm kind of off base here? Or do you think God might be nudging me in this direction, right? And so that's what the angel tells Cornelius to do. Just don't take my word. Go talk to this Peter guy. So we learn something from that. But there's a second reason that the angel came and told Cornelius to go talk to Peter. It was important for the church to know that the church isn't just for Jewish people. Like we mentioned to the kids this morning. I mean, God knew, and it's in the Old Testament, that everyone is supposed to be welcome to be followers of his. But the church had to realize that. And God had to make the 12 apostles who were leading the church open to that idea. And to do that, he had to talk to Peter, who was the leader first, right? And so then when Peter was convinced, then the door would be open to the rest of the world. And Cornelius was the prototype. So God, by doing it this way, he was trying to send a message to the church. And, you know, if you were Cornelius, you might have been tempted to think that the angel's visit was a special gift to you and to your family. And in a sense, it was, I guess. It would have been an honor to be the first Gentile family to join the church. But in another sense, the angel's visit to Cornelius wasn't about him at all. If you read on in Acts, you see that it was just the sort of the launching pad for this whole mission to get the gospel into the rest of the Roman Empire, to the rest of the world. And Cornelius is our spiritual great-great-great-great-grandfather, in a sense. If there hadn't been a Cornelius, we wouldn't be in this church here today. So that lets us know sometimes the things that are going on in our lives, it's more than just about us, right? It maybe the struggle that you're going through, maybe the difficulty that you're experiencing, it's not just for you to battle through. It might be that you're going through it so that your children or grandchildren will look at that situation and learn something from it. And so if they go through something similar or their friends go through something similar, they'll have some wisdom that they glean from you for whatever is happening in their lives in the future. And so that's we have to remember when God is working in our lives, it's about us, absolutely, but maybe there's other things going on too. We have an impact greater than what we realize. We have a mission bigger than what we understand. And it's going to get done whether we realize what's going on or not. So that could be why sometimes we're going through the difficulties that we are or experiencing the joys that we are. It's about God's bigger plan. And this is the third reason why God arranged for Cornelius to go call on Peter. Cornelius didn't just need the truth. He didn't just need to have a personal relationship with God only. He also needed the church, the Christian community. He didn't just need a special mystical experience. There's nothing wrong with that, but he didn't just need that. He needed contact with other people, with other Christians. And he needed to know what the truth could do in the lives of regular folks. I'd like to tell a story or retell a story I've told before. There was a Lutheran church in East Germany back in 1982, and there was a pastor there who was bothered by the fact that they were living under this repressive communism, but he didn't know what he could do about it, right? In East Germany, they kind of let the church function a little bit, but they tightly controlled it, and if you were a part of it, well, then you'd be discriminated against. Your kids wouldn't get good jobs. Maybe they couldn't go to university, all that kind of stuff. So this pastor was living under this kind of this awful regime, and he said, what can I do? Well, the only thing I can do is pray. So he set aside Monday nights in his church to pray for peace. He couldn't pray for anything else because it would look like it was revolutionary if he would have prayed for the overthrow of the government. He couldn't do that, so he just prayed for peace. And nobody could say that was wrong. So a couple people joined him for this prayer meeting, and they met for a few years with maybe just two or three people coming, praying for peace. But he was tempted to get discouraged because only two or three people were showing up, but he didn't get discouraged. He just thought it was the important thing to pray for, so he kept on praying for peace. Eventually, a few more people joined him. Eventually, it got up to 100, then 150. And then it was a big church, one of those old cathedral churches in Leipzig. Eventually, the church was filled. So there was about 15,000 people that started showing up praying for peace on Monday nights in this church. Eventually, after they finished their prayer service, they began walking in the streets, also praying for peace, singing hymns, carrying candles. And this got the attention of others. And so other people who couldn't fit in the church would join them. And so there were 55,000 people would join these 15,000 people in the church and begin walking through the streets and singing and praying for peace. But the government didn't like that, right? The communist government didn't like that. And so they said, we have to end this. You know, it's just too large. Sure, they're praying for peace, they're singing hymns, etc., but too many people. So they had an elaborate plan. They cleared the fairgrounds in Leipzig to make a concentration camp for the leaders of these meetings. They cleared the hospitals of patients because they'd instructed their troops to fire on these marchers and prayers for peace, and they expected a slaughter. And so they thought, we'll need space in the hospitals. And they were even more clever yet. They planted some people within the group. They planted spies of their own within the group of demonstrators with instructions to cause a disturbance, to start a fight. And once the fight was started, that would give reason for the troops to fire on the crowd, right? It would be a pretext. And finally, 2 days before their planned crackdown, they did a practice run of how to crush a demonstration. They did it in Arnstadt, a smaller town nearby. So it seemed like a foolproof plan. The German Secret Service was going to stop this prayer meeting. But the prayer meeting attendees knew that something was up. They didn't know what. They didn't know what was going to happen. But on Monday, October the 9th, 1989, the night started as usual, first as always, with the prayer meeting. 15,000 people left the church. And then they were joined by another 55,000, and they marched peacefully carrying candles and singing hymns. But when they got to the Secret Service headquarters, then the spies that the Secret Service had planted within the group of demonstrators began to do their part. They rushed out intending to attack the Secret Service headquarters building to start the pretext for the troops to fire. But seeing this happen, the churchgoers, who just finished hearing a sermon about peace, took action. They surrounded the Secret Service building, preventing the spies from reaching it. And then they also surrounded the spies with just their bodies, preventing them from getting violent or behaving in any way inappropriately, kind of cordoning them off. As a result, there was no disturbance and the soldiers had no reason to fire on the crowds. And later reports said that the soldiers were confused. They were prepared for an insurrection. They weren't prepared for people singing hymns, right? And maybe God answered those prayers for peace that night. Well, news spread about the success of this demonstration in Leipzig and the impotence of the Secret Service forces. That encouraged other demonstrations across East Germany. And within a week, Erich Honecker, the East German communist leader, had resigned. Within a month, the Berlin Wall was down. And then that was the beginning of the end for the collapse of other communist regimes in Eastern Europe.
Participated in all of this, we begin our story with Mari, whose family witnessed the rise and fall of Soviet domination in her country of Estonia.
Since you lived in the USSR, you weren't allowed to go to church or baptized or any of that. And when I was older, I really questioned that. I asked my mom, I was like, well, why am I not baptized? I would really like to do that. And when Estonia broke off from Russia, there were masses of people that
went lineups around the church for people to get baptized.
Well, not really that bad, but yeah, it was. I know that my confirmation class, we had 127 people.
Mari was there during what was called the Singing Revolution.
Yes.
It was a bloodless coup. This was a truly bloodless. There was no war, no person. Did a single person die?
No.
So they separated from Russia, became a single free country, and nobody died.
The collapse of communism, what the American military machine had failed to do, and what the solidarity movement in Poland had failed to do, a group of people in a prayer meeting was able to pull off. The irony of it was Erich Honecker, the East German communist leader, he had to flee for his life. And very ironically, the only people that would offer him and his wife shelter at that in the whole East Germany were a Lutheran pastor and his wife, who let them stay in the church in Parsonage. And so not only did communism collapse, but for some time afterwards, there was a religious revival in these communist countries. So when God responds to prayer, when he chooses to act through the Christian community, amazing things can happen. And that's why God values the stuff we do. That's why it's important what we do, even if we're not perfect people, even if our buildings aren't perfect places, even if, you know, we're not perfect in what we do, it doesn't really matter. We give witness and testimony to the greater purposes and plans of God. And now and then we see God act, now and then we see him act really powerfully. And so that's what Cornelius gave birth to. His involvement, God's calling him into the church, gave birth to. If there hadn't been a Cornelius, there wouldn't have been the collapse of the communist regime in Eastern Europe either, right? So Cornelius teaches a few things. He teaches us that the patterns the way we look at the world aren't always God's patterns. You know, we want to take down a military machine with military power, but God maybe has a different plan. He wants to do it through prayer. We have a view that people have to go through certain steps in a certain order if they're going to come to Jesus. God maybe can do it in a different way, right? A Pentecostal pastor friend I knew in Medicine Hat used to say to me, I used to think I was a good Christian, but I realized really that I was just mad that he was God and I wasn't. I think that's what Cornelius reminds us of. You know, God can do things a little differently than we're used to, than what we think should happen. We've got to be open to his leading. Like Peter and Cornelius, let's remember that God is bigger than us. Thankfully, let's remember the power of prayer, the importance of the church, the importance of sharing the good news throughout the world, the importance of God's power working in the church, and the importance of the mission that we have, and the importance of as Rick was saying last week, just if you sense God is leading you to do something and go in a certain area, just do it and see what happens.